Hi everyone, my name is Pavel and I'm an Identity Ace engineer in Microsoft. As an application administrator in Microsoft Entra ID, you often need to utilize groups so that you can manage authorization efficiently. In most organizations, application admins and security or user access admins must be different people, making this the only option. While this gives you a lot of flexibility and helps reduce the management overhead, there are a few limitations to be aware of, and also some best practices to get the most out of it. In this video, we'll talk about the basics of using groups and some common troubleshooting you can do to make it work. First, let's look at one of the most commonly used patterns, assigned access for applications. When the service principal, aka enterprise application, has this flag set to yes, only users that are explicitly assigned will be able to get a token for the application. Everyone else would get an error 50105. Assignments can target users individually with no additional requirements, dependent a lot on manual or scripted processes, and potentially hitting the limit of 1500 apps assignment per user. Most often, you would only have user or default access built-in role available for selection. Or you can use security groups here, in which case there are a few considerations. Microsoft Entra ID premium license is required. On a free tier, you'll get the message groups are not available and cannot select the groups for assignment. Nested groups are not supported. If the group you select for assignment has other groups as a member, only the direct members of the select group will get the assignment. Transitive memberships are not expanded as part of the process. You can use both plain security groups and M365 groups, either of dynamic user or assigned membership type. Note that dynamic group membership evaluation is not instantaneous, so authorization changes can get delayed if you use them. Same 1500 limit applies to the groups themselves. They can only have that many direct role assignments. Do not confuse these app authorization groups with role assignable groups. Those are required for HR back roles only. Application role assignments work with regular security groups that don't have the flag set. Assigning the license for a group is no different than doing that for a single user. You can easily select it in the interface as long as you have the required premium licensing. So how do you actually utilize these groups to determine what the user is allowed to do inside the application after signing in? For that, we need to inform the application which groups the user is a member of. By including this information as a claim on the issued token, it's not always set by default, so you may need to configure it. There are important size limitations for using this claim that are commonly overlooked. If the user is a member of too many groups, 150 for SAML applications or 200 for OIDC, the full groups list would not be sent on the token. Instead, a link to retrieve that list would be included and the application needs to expect that and be able to retrieve them. If the application uses implicit flow, the claim has a limit of 5 groups. Should the user be a member of more than that, the token would only have a has groups true claim on it instead of the actual groups list. It is always best to use the MS graph to retrieve the groups whenever possible. If the application owner says they are not receiving the groups claim after you configured it, the most probable cause is there are too many groups to send. Minimizing number of groups has the added benefit of limiting security information spill. Almost never an application has a legitimate need to have knowledge of all user groups. There are multiple ways to limit the number of groups emitted on the token. Use assigned groups, we already talked about. We'll see how to configure this later in this video. This is the simplest method that doesn't require a lot of modifications from basic configuration. Use app roles. This is the preferred method to use whenever possible, as it allows you to only expose relevant information about your users, decoupling user management from application configuration. Note that both assigned groups and app roles do not support nesting. Use groups claim filtering. A somewhat more advanced scenario, that may involve extensive configuration or use claims mapping policies, a very flexible way to configure claims for the application. For some applications, you may see a banner, "This configuration was overwritten." This means the application already has a claims mapping policy assigned to it, and you won't be able to edit the issued claims, including the groups, in the portal. Now, let's look at SAML applications. The most straightforward way to configure the claim in the Entra Admin Center Enterprise Application section. Go to the application you want to configure, open the single sign-on blade, select the Edit on the Attribute and Claims tile. There you will have a plus Add Group Claim button. If it's grayed out, means that the claim has already been added. There is a hard limit on only one group's claim in the token. If that's the case, no problem. Just find the claim in the Additional Claims section that has the value of User Groups, and you can edit it as required. You can also delete the claim from the list if not needed. When creating or editing an existing group's claim configuration, you have multiple options available to you. Let's quickly walk through them. None is just that. No claim would be sent. Select it on an existing claim or remove the claim from the list, same as deleting. All groups means any Entra ID group, security, distribution or M365 that the user is a member of, both cloud and synced, will be included in the claim, potentially hitting the size limit. Security groups, both cloud and synced security groups are included, still easily going over the size limit. Directory roles, a highly specialized scenario where instead of groups, RPAC roles are sent as WIDS claim. Group's claim would not be sent. Let's quickly try this one out. Here we will sign in with a test user account and see that the user did not get a group's claim and instead has the link only. Any of the first three options are rarely recommended for use due to potential token bloat, as we have seen in the example before, and security information oversharing, unless you have a very specific requirement that you can only be met with those. Here, our test user has more than 200 groups. Generally, it's best to use the last option of groups assigned to the application. This would only send the groups explicitly added to the application configuration like we discussed previously. Nested groups are not supported here either. A user must be a direct member of the group. Here, we can see that only three group IDs have been passed. But if we look at the application configuration, there are four groups assigned to it. The All Hybrid Users group only has another group as a member and no direct member users. That is why it is omitted on the claim. Additionally, you can select what will be the identifier for the groups included in the claim. General recommendation is to keep that at the default setting of group ID. If for some reason you need to use other identifiers, most often for migrating applications from ADFS, you can pick a suitable one from the drop-down list. But for cloud groups, those attributes are not available, so they will be omitted on the claim, showing only sync groups to the application. Last option allows you to send the display name for cloud-only groups. You can only use that with the assigned groups as selected above. Checkbox with the same name allows you to send cloud group names on the claim when one of the sync-based options is selected from the drop-down list. Of the advanced options, let's configure the alternative name for the claim.
With this configuration, when we sign out and sign back in again, we would only receive the renamed claim with a single on-premises sync group on it. For OpenID Connect or OAuth applications, the look would be a bit different. Key thing to remember, the group's claim cannot be added or configured by you for third-party apps deployed from the gallery, or added by direct consent when the user just signs into the app if allowed in the organization. Only the app owner can make that configuration. So for these third-party apps, the button will be grayed out. If you are configuring your own instance of non-gallery app or an application that your organization maintains, you have the full power to modify the claims as you need. But to do so, you start with the app registration object, not the enterprise application. Here you will go to the token configuration section and click the plus add groups claim. If the claim already exists, the button will still say as add, but will in fact change settings of an existing claim and not create a second one. you will have a very similar configuration allowing you to select security groups, directory roles or groups, or the recommended groups assigned to the application option. You can then customize the attribute that will be used as the source, same as we had for SAML applications, except there is no option to use the cloud-only display name. Same restrictions apply if you select anything other than a group ID. Only synced groups will be present on the claim. Now let's sign with our test account and go through the OIDC code grant flow. In the end, we will receive a groups claim showing two of the groups that the user is a member of. This concludes the basics of how to use groups for authorization in applications with Entra ID. Thank you for watching.